सर्वपापाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणी अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। संततगं शिलाभिस्तु लंबत्याकोशसन्निभं तस्यान्ते सुषिरगं सूक्ष्मं तस्मिन् सर्वं प्रतिष्ठितम्। Here, as I told you last time, there is reference to the nadis. According to the Ayurvedic science, there are 72,000 nadis, and out of them 101 are more important, and out of these again the 101st nadi, called Sushumna nadi, it starts from the heart, passes through the Brahmarandhra, the crown of the head, and then connects it with the Satyaloka or Brahmaloka. So at the time of death, if the Jivatma manages to go through the Sushumna nadi, through the Brahmarandhra, then through the Archiradi Marga, or the bright path, as described in the Upanishads and the Gita, he travels to, goes to Brahmaloka and doesn't come back. And the Sutta is also telling that inside this heart, inside the Sushumna nadi, the Jivatman is established, and ultimately he is Paramatman himself. Since the entire universe is established in the Paramatman, it is as good as telling that the whole universe or whatever exists is established in the Jivatman also, because ultimately there is no difference between them. Tasya madhye mahan agnihi vishvarchihi vishvathomukaha sograbhugvibhajan tishtan aharan ajaraha kavihi तिर्यक ऊर्ध्वम अधश्यायी रश्मयस्तस्य संतता। There is a great fire in the midst of this, in the heart, in the Dharakasha, or inside the Sushumna nadi, and that great fire is responsible for keeping this body alive, for digesting the food that is offered to it, and distributing the essence of the food to the various parts of the body. Tasya madhye vishvarchihi vishvato mukha mahan agnihi vartate saha agrabhut aharam vibhajam ajaraha kavihi tasya rashmiyah tiryak urdhvam adhashyayi santataha. We know that when the body is alive, full of life and energy, there is heat. When the body is dead, this heat is gone. What is it that gives this heat to this body, keeps it alive, keeps it conscious? That is the Jivatman, who is also ultimately Paramatman according to the Advaitic school. This is called as, he is called here as Agni. This Agni is established within. He has his rays, or the rays of fire, the rays of light going from him in all directions. Not only that, whatever is taken by the body through the mouth or through the various sense organs, because ahara can mean both. The physical food taken through the mouth, and also the various experiences that come through the indriyas. He is the first person inside the body who receives them, enjoys them, and the essence of that is distributed by him to the various parts of the body, keeping them alive. But in the process, does he himself get affected? The Sukta says, no. He is agrabhut, aharam vibhajan vartate, but he is ajara. He himself is not digested, he is not affected, he doesn't get deteriorated in the process. Why? Because he is the eternal being. The Sukta uses a word which is also used in the Upanishad with reference to this Jivatma, and that is Kavi. Normally in vernaculars, even in Sanskrit, a Kavi is a poet. Generally he looks at the universe or the things around him or the thoughts and feelings that may arise in him due to various experiences in life and puts them in a beautiful language in the form of a poem. So one who is capable of writing poetry is a poet, Kavi. But here the word is used in a more technical sense, and the etymological definition given by Shankara and others is Kavi, he means Kranta Darshi, one who is able to see beyond. That means one who has intuitive perception of things. An ordinary person may just see the piece of glass here, but a nuclear scientist can see what is inside it. Though he may not physically perceive it, it is possible for him to perceive it through the intuitive internal eye. Something like that, those who have realized the Atman, they are able to see the truth behind the whole universe. So here the Jivatman who is established inside the body, who is also the Paramatman, or the Paramatman who is inside him again as the Antaryami, he is described as Kavi, Kranta Darshi, who is Sarvajna, Sarvashakta, and so on. When we look at this world, we have to wonder how great must have been the intellect that has created this universe. In fact, there is a beautiful sutra in the Brahma Sutras, Rachananupatyescha Nanumanam. After describing the various statements taken from the Upanishads, giving the correct meaning and interpretation, and refuting the allegations of the opposite schools, the Brahma Sutra takes up from the fifth pada, that is the second pada of the second section. There the criticism of the other schools of philosophy begins. And the first school that is taken up for criticism is the Sankhyan school. Pradhana Malla Nibarhana Nyayena. That is how Shankara puts it. See, we have to, suppose there is a great wrestler. There are many other wrestlers who are challenging him. So this wrestler has to establish his superiority over the others. He doesn't go on fighting with or wrestling with the ordinary wrestlers. He will choose the best among them. If the best or the greatest wrestler is first conquered, then it is as good as conquering everybody else. So among the various schools to be countered by Vedanta, the Sankhya system is the greatest opponent and the most powerful opponent, because the Sankhyan ideas are based upon the Upanishads, and the interpretations they give almost seem to be supported by the Upanishadic passages and philosophy. So Sankhyan school is taken up first for criticism, and this sutra begins that criticism. Rachana anupapattehe cha na anumanam. The universe that we see in front of us, it cannot have been created by Prakriti or Pradhana. Anumana means here Prakriti or Pradhana, the insentient nature which is put forward by the Sankhyan school as the basis for the whole creation. It says that Prakriti has created the universe, evolving itself due to the impulse given to it by the presence of the Purusha or the Atma. That is their philosophy. But the Brahma Sutras, the word Brahma Sutras is countering it by telling Rachana Anubhupatteshchana Anumanam. Rachana, the way this world has been created, it is so wonderfully organized. It is not possible for an insentient Prakriti, which has no life, no intelligence of its own, to create such a wonderful, such a beautiful universe. So this Jagat Rachana Kaushalya belongs to Ishvara, Paramatman, Atman, and not to Prakriti. That is the idea that is being propagated there. So this Kavi is that, the Sarvajna Sarvashakta, the Krantadarshi, who has created this whole universe, the Supreme Intelligence. It is he who is described here as Kavi, as the Jivatman living inside the body, giving it heat, giving it life, giving it power and strength. And he is also called as Vaishvanara or Vaishvanaratma in the Upanishads. In the Gita, we have a shloka. Aham Vaishvanaro Bhutva Praniyam Deham Ashritaha Pranapana Samayuktaha Pachamyanam Chaturvidham. So, in the bodies of the various living beings, I am established as the Vaishvanaratman, as the Jivatman inside the heart, and it is I who digest the various types and kinds of food that are fed into the body through prana, apana and other vital airs. So who is this Vaishvanara Atman or Vaishvanara Agni? The digestive power is also called as Vaishvanara Agni. This discussion is also there in the Upanishads and based upon that in the Brahma Sutras also. In the Chandogya Upanishad, especially in the 5th chapter, there is one section called Vaishvanara Vidya. Vaishvanara is Jivatman living inside the body, who accepts the food, takes it, digests it and distributes the essence of that food to the various parts of the body, as this Narayana Sutta indicates here. There the Upanishad is telling, when a person eats the food, the first morsel, the second morsel, the third morsel, the fourth and the fifth, he has to utter certain mantras, imagining that he is offering this, just as we offer oblations into a consecrated fire. In the same way, the food that I am taking is actually an oblation or an offering into the Vaishvanara Agni inside. So pranaya swaha, apanaya swaha and so on. So the act of eating itself is converted into Agnihotra in the spiritual sense. So this is one of the most wonderful means and methods of meditation that the Upanishads have given to us. This part is called as, you have heard of the Aranyaka portions of the Vedas. So Aranyakas are also called as Upasana Kanda. So it is a stage in between the regular Vedic sacrifices and Atma Jnana. A person has just withdrawn himself from the householder's life. He has not yet taken sannyas, he is a vanaprastha. So he is living in the forest. At that time, the samskara of the Vedic sacrificial religion has not left him, but he is neither capable of doing it because of age and physical weaknesses, nor is it necessary for him to do it at that stage. He has to do it slowly. Weaned away from the sacrificial religion to the level of meditation. Upasana. So the Aranyaka portions of the Vedas, have given symbolical interpretations to the various rituals of sacrifice, instead of performing the sacrifices physically outside, he has to imagine them inside. And what about the results? Whatever result a person gets by performing that particular ritual outside, 100 times greater result will be achieved through meditation upon that ritual in a symbolical way inside. That is how they put it. So the act of eating, which is common to every one of us, if there is no upasana behind it, it just becomes an act of eating, and it is going to maintain the body, its health and strength and energy. But if the same act of eating is associated with these mantras, with these thoughts and feelings, with the type of meditation prescribed in the Upanishad, then it becomes Vaishvanara Upasana Pranagnihotra. It is not ordinary Agnihotra, but it is Agnihotra to the Pranashakti, and it automatically becomes Upasana or meditation upon the Vaishvanara Purusha inside, and the results achieved are tremendous. So here we see the descriptions given in the Narayana Sukta are in perfect consonance with the Upasana on the Vaishvanara or Vaishvanara Vidya given in the Chandogya Upanishad, and the meditation described here is also similar to that. In fact, the meditation given in the Narayana Sukta goes even one step further, because ultimately it leads to Atma Jnana or Brahma Jnana by meditating upon the light within the region of the heart as the Atman. That will be described in the next section. Santapayati Swam Deham Apada Talamastakaha. From Pada to Mastaka, from the feet up to the head, the whole body is kept living, alive. And a living body has heat inside it. Heat is the sign of life. Who is it that keeps this body alive? Who is it that gives it heat to live like that? Santapayati Swam Deham Apada Talamastakaha. The Atman who is described in the previous verse as Kavi, the Jivatman, it is he who, living inside this body, is keeping it, is giving it heat, life, keeping it alive from the foot to the head, feet to the head. Santapayati Swam Deham. Tasya Madhye Vanji Shikha Aniyordhva Vyavasthitaha. Inside that Agni, in the midst of that Agni, there is a very small little flame which is going up, upwards. Urdhvamukha, Aniya and Urdhva. Aniya means very, very small, almost atomic. And it is, the direction is also given, it is going up. Now this Vanjishikha, which is very small and pointing upward, is actually pointing the direction to the Brahmaloka or Satyaloka. See, these are all very difficult concepts to understand. We have to depend heavily upon the commentators like Sayana Bhatta Bhaskara and others. So first thing we have to remember is that we have to practice meditation in the region of the heart, Hridaya. And the heart is compared to a lotus bud. A bud which is closed, which has not yet bloomed, and which is hanging downwards. So gradually in the process of meditation, it opens up and the Atman inside that is revealed. Inside this heart, which is like a bud, there is a small little space called Dharakasha. Or this heart is surrounded by 101 nadis out of which one nadi is most important, that is directly connected to this heart, and that connects this heart through the Brahmarandhra to the Satyaloka. Both interpretations are given. Inside that there is this Agni. Agni can be imagined to be inside the heart or inside the Sushumna nadi. This Agni is blazing and its flames are extending to all parts of the body through the various nadis. And it is that which is keeping the body alive. So far, so good. Now the next mantra goes one step further and says, even in the midst of this Agni, within that, Arnya Urdhva, in the midst of this Agni, there is one Vishikha, a flame, a brilliant flame. Inside this Agni are fire, and that is very small, atomic in size, and it is upwards, directed upwards or going towards the top. The next mantra gives a beautiful description of that flame which is within this fire. Nila toyada madhyastha vidyullekha iva bhaswara nivara shukavat tanvi pita bhaswati anupama. During the rainy season, they have the dark rainy clouds. Suppose there is a lightning against that. How does it look? That comparison is given here, simile is given here. Nila toyada. Toyada, that which gives water, that's the cloud. It is nila, it is dark in color. Inside that madhya, so the flame, the little tongue of flame that is referred to in the previous mantra, is established inside this Agni, and it is being compared to a streak of lightning against the background of dark clouds. Nila toyada madhyastha. So like the streak of lightning, it is burning brilliantly, but it is very small, very fine, very subtle, and the background is dark. Now why does he say that the background is dark? I'll explain it a little later. The second part of this mantra says, Nivara Shukavat Tanvi Pita Anupama Bhaswati. Nivara Shuka means the on of the paddy. You take a paddy grain, just a single paddy grain. On the top of that, there is a small portion, which is almost like a thorn, a very small thing. So the comparison is to that. Just like that, a small little thorn-like structure at the top of the grain of paddy, like that, this light also is very, very small, fine and subtle. And it is burning brilliantly like the lightning against dark clouds. But the color is also indicated. It is pita. It is not just pure white. It is yellowish white, like the golden color, we can say. One has to use one's imagination. So according to this, the Vaishvanara Atman or Agni or Jivatman being described here is extremely small, anu in size. Now this is a point which has been discussed in the Brahma Sutras. In the Upanishads there are quite a few statements which say that the Atman is anu. Yesho anuratma chetasa veditavyaha. Mundaka Upanishad says that this Atman is anu, very, very small, atomic in size. He can be known only through the pure mind. Then the Shvetashvatara Upanishad says, Valagra shatabhagasya shatadha kalpitasya cha भागो जीवस्य विज्ञेयः सच आनंत्याय कल्पते। सपोज यू टेक ए हेयर, ए सिंगल हेयर, एंड यू टेक द लास्ट पोर्शन, द एंड पोर्शन ऑफ दैट, देन डिवाइड इट इनटू 100 पोर्शंस, कट इट इनटू 100 पीसेस, अगेन अनदर 100, each one of the pieces is taken and divided further into 100 pieces. What is the size? Something like that. So the jiva is of that size, but he has got infinite power. He has the potency and the capacity to become infinite. Anantyaya kalpate. He can get anantatva. So that means, according to these Upanishadic statements, the Atman, Jivatman inside the body is of the size of, is of atomic size or anu. This point has been discussed in the Brahma Sutras. Utkranti Gati Adinam. Because Utkranti Gati etc. has been described for the Jivatman, therefore he is anu. It is very interesting. There is a series of sutras starting from the 19th sutra in the third section of the second chapter with this. So it goes on up to 32. There the whole trend of these various sutras is that the Atman or the Jivatman inside the body is anu parimana. He is atomic in size. All these sutras starting with this are accepted by Ramanuja and Madhva as the Siddhanta, as the primary teaching of the Brahma Sutras. Because according to them, the Vishishta Dvaitic and Dvaitic schools, Jiva is Anuparimana. Paramatman is Vibhu, Jivatman is Anu. That is their philosophy. If Jivatman is Anu, how can the whole body feel consciousness? This question is raised, and the commentators on these two systems, they say, suppose you keep a small little light in a room. It may be a small light kept in one place in the room, but its light, the burning light, the light emitted by it, it fills the whole room. Like that, Jivatman is Anuparimana. He lives in the region of the heart, but the consciousness pervades the whole body. That is their argument. Of course, this argument is not accepted by Advaita Shankara. So Shankara first deals with them as if they are all Siddhanta Sutras, answering objections against them. But when it comes to the Sutras 28, 29, 30, 32, then he says, this is the Siddhanta. All the earlier sutras are Purvapaksha sutras. So there are differences of opinion. But there is sufficient evidence to show that there was a school or certain schools or rishis, they did consider Jivatman as in parimana, atomic in size.